Should I just like go over there and use the vacuum?
Are they in there?
I don't know.
Let's get some.
We're cleaning up our stuff. You know what? I'm gonna go over there too.
Oh, oops. Good footage.
Hey, no guitar plug.
Right here.
So there's about a week left in school for us.
Ever.
Oh, there's
none of us are going to college. Oh, quite,
well, they don't seem to have any.
Better. Also, I don't know how you got it to a week.
It's like a
week. 2 weeks?
Whatever. More dramatic, right?
We figured we should do an overview, basically, of all the things about this robot we made for this year's competition. It's sort of broken, sort of falling apart, sort of taken apart, but...
Kind of, yeah.
Well, it is.
Yeah. Just the front roller, really.
Okay. Though.
Well, and the service here.
Oh, okay.
But...
That's fine.
We figured we should talk about it a bit.
Okay.
So
should I just like go over everything?
Yeah. We're just gonna talk about every design thing we can possibly think of.
Okay, right. So we'll start with the pickup mechanism, which is broken, but there were two steel arms. They're supposed to go one on each side. Right here and right here. Driven by quarter steel servos. So at the start of a match, our pickup roller, which is foam, would start folded up like that. And then at the beginning of the match would lower like that. Normally we would have the foam roller about 2 inches off the ground, and that would allow us to only pick up large balls. Like, oh, they took off the mouse pad.
They took off the mouse pad.
There was a sheet of mouse pad here, but basically it would pick up large balls into the trough. You can see on
the
top
small
here.
Balls would go like, mm.
But yeah, small balls wouldn't make it. However, because this was a rack and pinion, we could actually lower the foam roller further, and we would also pick up small balls. Once I get into this trough, you can see it rolls to the center. Oh yeah, this is the belt that drives this foam roller. Then I don't want to kill my hands.
These are turned by separate motors, by the way.
Yeah.
Even though they're rotating about the same axle.
And I gotta open
the circle. Made it so we could control the inner or outer individually.
Yeah.
So we could pick up 5 balls in this area and then toss them to the hopper.
So then I would load it into our vertical hopper. Here. One kind of funny thing.
Oh, do we have 5?
We did. Now we have 4. Our hopper wasn't long enough, we knew that at the very beginning, so we added this plastic bag at the top that pops up.
Oh, and breaks.
That doesn't normally happen. So it would hold 5.
Pretty much the robotics team now is dismantling everything, so...
They wanted this tape or something for this plastic bag, I guess.
I don't know what they did.
Anyway.
So now we'll talk about the lift sections. Our lift is 2-stage. We have a linear slide system, which is made of, I guess, linear slides. We can show that too. The whole robot like opens up. I'm not sure what this is showing. As you can see, the I guess slides, it's just a really complicated pulley system driven by 3 motors down in the bottom here.
Yeah.
And then
it's a plate here to keep balls from getting in.
Oh yeah, that's another thing about our pickup. If balls fall in our robot, they go to the pickup. And then we just pick the balls up again, which is kind of nice.
That's pretty handy.
We had 2 lift motors. I'm dumb. Oh, here are the 2 lift motors, they're Andymark motors. We've got 2 spools, one on each side.
Driven by an axle, of course.
Yeah.
This whole panel at the bottom comes out for easy. Access, sort of, somewhat easy access at least.
Okay, that's good enough for that.
You can see some of our nifty wire management in here is fairly good, actually, I would say.
Okay, yeah. Another cool thing. This is for a GoPro, so it faces up and you can see cool stuff. So the second section of the lift is this linkage, which is driven by 4 quarter scale servos. They're
Yeah, they're from a company called Palulu High Torque.
Honestly, yeah. I would not recommend these because they're bad.
Yeah, they're really cheap
and they're really powerful. One of these is stronger than one of these quarter scale servos.
And faster.
But way worse. They're not precise at all and they love to break. So, wouldn't recommend them. But.
Anyway, as this first segment of the lift is going up, we also have this flip across because our goal is clamped. The goal is clamped back here, and we'll talk about that later. But, so we have two sections going at once to speed things up, and then you just drop the ball circling into the two.
This thing would be for center goal or something.
Yeah, it's pretty tall.
If we wanted to, we use this for center goal.
We could
rotate this whole thing. It's controlled by this quarter scale servo here. This whole thing could pivot to either side. Actually, can rotate 180 degrees, but we wouldn't do that because.
Have you explained what this is?
This is a guitar club. Just coexisting with them. It'll be okay.
Okay. Go forwards.
Anyway,
yeah, we had our hopper be vertical because it would dump out balls a lot faster than horizontal hoppers. We can dump out balls individually with the servo. Another kind of cool thing was in autonomous, we would occasionally grab the wrong goal if we were like rammed. Because the hopper is vertical though, it doesn't matter if the goal is way down here, it will still make it in.
Yeah.
So a lot of times we would score in like the small goal, even though we meant to score in the large goal.
Honestly, it was okay. Real stoppers here. This timing belt thingy has a little adjustable screw here, which makes for pretty easy adjusting of this pivot. Like that.
I can't actually do it.
Well, it adjusts the angle of the hopper. So, when we packed it to Oakland, we could, when we got there, we could calibrate this, make sure it's the right angle.
So it doesn't shoot off the humidity. The humidity changed the tension of the belt.
Yeah, exactly.
In terms of wire management, I guess it's pretty straightforward. We have the wires coming from the servos going to the two splitters. These all turn the same direction when we do things correctly.
We can show these nifty clips.
Oh, yeah, we 3D printed these.
Yeah, so we kept on.
You guys should do this. They're good.
Yeah, you can. We have models of this that you guys can have. They're on our Google Drive, which is public, I think.
Yeah.
Anyway, we just printed these clips, snap them on, and they won't pull apart. They're pretty nice.
So we've got two servo splitters that come around here, and then there's an encoder, I think. There's an encoder over there.
That reads the position of this whole system.
Yeah, so servo splitters. They just go down this. I think we made about six versions of this thing.
Oh, yeah. And this one's not even that good.
This one's not that great, to be honest. But, you know.
All the wires then come out here, and all the controllers.
And then they explode. Let's show the toolkit, because it happened to be right near.
Okay, well, the toolkit has an Allen wrench and, what was that thing?
Flat wrench on it normally.
We recommend this, actually.
Yeah. Velcro's on, so you can just take it off right before the match when you realize you've forgotten to screw all of your bolts in, and just tighten them up real quick. Stick it back on there. Hypothetically, that's legal. Flag holder's also right here, I guess.
Oh, yeah, the flag holder.
That's cut out of a block party block.
They make great flag holders.
One thing we haven't talked about at all is the pickup or the clamp system.
Yeah. Well, first let's just do these.
Okay, these are kind of cool.
The latches.
We have acrylic sides protecting blocks, but just clips on like that.
And then you can push that in and it comes out. You want to talk about these real quick?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay.
This one actually is kind of good.
We wanted everything to be super easy to replace and stuff on this.
Oh, they took the chain off.
Oh, yeah. They stole their chain. Well, yeah, and really sloppily too.
So this thing is really cool. If you guys have access to a water jet cutter, you should do it. We didn't want to have to use a wrench when we wanted to replace our motors. So we have, normally you would just stick an Allen wrench in one side through that hole and you put a flat wrench on the other side. But we actually water jetted what's basically a wrench and bolted it to the back of this motor mount. That's what these two little prongs are. So we don't even need a wrench, you just stick an Allen wrench and it holds the nut while you loosen it.
And this hole was made, that was there from the beginning, that was water jetted in to that piece, because when we were building CAD, we were like, well, have to be able to get to every screw. And I think, for the most part, in terms of doing this in CAD and having it come together, there's only really one thing that we sort of derped on, and that was a standoff that was supposed to go. You can see these two sides are joined by standoff mostly. Also, all of these are mounted with bearings, of course, all of these pulleys and stuff. This side is the chain missing. But there was supposed to be a standoff, like, right here. You can't see the hole for it, which ended up hitting something, so we had to take that out. But otherwise, it all came together pretty nicely.
Yeah.
You want to talk about doing the chain in CAD?
Yeah, in Autodesk Inventor, there's a chain tensioner that we use that you can just pretty much just tell two positions for where wheels need to be, and it will give you the amount of chain, and if it's off by like a little bit, it will tell you that you need to, you know, have these two positions be at those two spots. It's kind of a really useful, quick way to figure out how far chain needs to be apart.
Hey, how much would you guys say this thing's worth, like, once it's complete?
Worth? It is done already.
Yeah. What do you mean?
What do you mean, like cost?
Like, just how much do you guys estimate?
Oh, how much did we put into it, or?
Or just, like, if you get sold it. $1,000. I'm just saying, two? Wow.
But, I mean, that's just, like, materials. We spent a lot of time.
Yeah.
And so if you just calculated at minimum wage between five people, it would come out to a lot.
Yeah, because, like, let's see, 5,000 hours maybe? I don't know.
Awesome.
Thanks.
So, this is kind of cool. It's...
Oh, you want to talk about the guides, maybe?
That's what I was going to do. These also count as the horns on our robot because we needed some. But we wanted to lock the hopper in a single position for when it's loading, because if it were off, that would be bad. So these axles slip into these slots, and it kind of locks the hopper in place, so it can't move. I mean, you can pick up the robot with the hopper now. Next, I guess
we'll... Oh, foam roller, yeah, that's important.
Our clamp uses a foam roller. We kind of got the idea from the foam roller we used for Block Party. Hang on, I just want...
Anyway, basically the idea is this sucks the goal in. This is my personal favorite part of the robot. By the way, you can see that our base plate is made out of steel.
I was going to take that.
It's rusty. Oh, go ahead.
Well, I'll do this first. But so we got two NXT motors driving this foam roller. We got an arc, same size as the Pentagon. So you just drive up to a goal and you can just suck it in. Doesn't matter which direction it is, it'll still be lined up perfectly.
Yeah. That's pretty important.
Yeah, our base plate is steel. One kind of nice thing you'll notice is I'm not holding the bolt on the other side. That's because just like with these motor mounts, all the bolts are already like locked in place.
As you can see, this separate plate is what we were talking about earlier with the two motors for the lift. It comes off separately with these two things here. You can see these slide a little bit so they can be tensioned separately.
Yeah, the chain.
Anyway, our clamp really makes it nice that we can go to the exact same position every time, but if the goal is in a, if the goal tube is slightly crooked, we were one of the few teams that could actually recover from that by adjusting the position of the hopper. Additionally, we had the software thing programmed in there, where if we adjusted the position of the hopper once, the next time we went up to dump, it would go back to that same adjusted position. So if we had to tweak a little bit for a goal that was tweaked, we could just go back to the same position and it would all be preserved.
So you can see our drive base, it's six wheeled. The drive base actually kind of messed up at Super Regionals.
Robot got a little too heavy. I think this wheel is...
Yeah, that's interesting. Good. This chain is better. This chain is not better.
They took their chain off.
but yeah, so...
Oh, yeah, you can see here this thing bowing out because that axle is...
Okay. But. Whatever. So yeah, we can take off the base plate if we need to do maintenance. I guess we can talk about the frame a bit. Yeah. Basically, our robot is two humongous panels, eighth-inch aluminum, water-jetted, and then we have these angle aluminum extrusion. The frame actually isn't not going across. It's kind of sketchy, but
yeah.
We have one piece of U-channel here. This is quarter-inch steel.
Yeah, that may have been a little bit of overkill in hindsight. Our robot ended up weighing about 45 pounds.
Yeah.
See, now this is a great angle, just seeing some of the water jetting slash origami that went on.
Yeah, that was not water jetting. To everything make this... else was. Oh, if we burned out pickup motors, off the base
not too bad to get them.
And then for lift motors, since I just took this off, what is it cut on?
Well, there's this little bar thingy to keep the tension in the chain the same.
Yeah, but it's wired.
One thing that's kind of interesting is that we made our own motor mounts with C clamps and U-channel. So you can see there, this is just a C clamp.
Don't care anymore.
Really a lot smaller and a lot more robust than the Andy Mark motor mounts or the Tetris motor mounts, that is.
Yeah. Normally this plate like comes all the way off, but our wires are so tight that we can't. Oh, now you can kind of see these. These like aluminum plates that are stacked up are also wrenches. So these bolts won't fall out of our robot. They're just, you know, locked in there.
Yeah.
So we can just put on the nut and tighten it. And that's easy.
One thing worth pointing out, that axle we mentioned earlier, a lot of the axles on this robot actually are what diameter?
Oh, 6mm, yeah.
As opposed to the Tetris ones, that's a lot better in our opinion. You can sort of see the difference here. It's the normal diameter, there's a 6mm down there.
Yeah.
The wheel ones are thicker. That, the 6mm size is the size that all the motor hubs will fit, and that worked out really well for us because we have a ton of motor hubs and like no axle hubs. Oh yeah, that's up too. And like no axle hubs, so making that switch actually worked out pretty well. Good view of the bearings.
Oh yeah.
Too.
Those are from Servo City. They're fairly cheap bearings.
To be honest, mounting our robot got too heavy in the end to have a very good drive to drive very well. But if you do this water jet stuff, if you have all of your axles be perfectly perpendicular to the panels and perfectly parallel to each other, and you have well tension chained and you have bearing mounts, it really makes a difference. That said, if you just want to win, that's not what's going to do it. That doesn't really matter. But it does make a difference. I remember the first time we drove this thing, just the comparison to the last few years was amazing. How little it was.
Let's see, any other kind of cool stuff? Because we ended up going with a foam roller for our pickup, we could actually move it all the way to the down position and use it like the same way that we used the back foam roller for clamping goals. So we can move around multiple goals at once.
Another kind of cool thing, this channel here is the perfect width to fit 5 balls basically. So we could run the roller during autonomous and just suck it in and it would mechanically stop it from picking up too many and killing itself.
Yeah.
That would be, like I said, these run independently, these two. Roller thingies.
Yeah.
So if you just run the outer one, you can pick up 5 in here before running the earlier one and sucking them off in the thing. That also means that we could pick up more balls when the hopper was up. We could pick, once we dumped, as soon as we dumped, we could start, and actually the plan was to automate this. So as soon as you press the dump button, the outer roller would start and you'd be picking up balls again, but the inner roller would be off until you got to, until it got all the way down, at which point the inner roller would automatically turn back on and suck them up. So hypothetically, you could get really tight cycles, but we were never any good at driving this thing. So.
Yeah. We don't have the prototype board on here. We never used it. But after 2 years of complaining, I finally made Ernest a nice prototype board mount.
Was the 2 years of complaining you complaining or him complaining?
It was everyone complaining. Yeah. I wish I had the piece here, but basically we made like a keyhole slot.
Yeah, Kieran Losh represent.
Yeah.
Where's the bathroom?
The bathroom? Go out to the left and then.
Like a key.
Oh, yeah. A key?
If you go into Mr. Bratt's room and you ask him, he has one. You go. But basically, we had 4 of those keyhole slots laser cut onto an acrylic sheet that the prototype board was mounted to. And then you could just pop it in and slide it down and it would lock in place. Here's our battery mount. It's not very exciting.
Although we actually put it in CAD this year and did it all fancily, as opposed to just like duct taping it on at the last second.
Other random things. These pulley guides. Having your string fall off.
That's bad. Don't do that. That was pretty much the story of our first year with.
Yeah.
Whatever that game was called, Ring It Up. It was just like, and the lift is, oh no. We had a single use lift, I guess you could say.
You can get the models for those too. These bearings are half inch.
V bearings?
Yeah, half inch V bearings. We got them off eBay. They're pretty cheap and they're really nice.
Well, jury's still out on whether a V shape is.
They're better
the best.
Than 3D printing them
yes.
or lathing them yes. yourself because we're dumb.
If you do decide to make this investment, although it's not that big, you should maybe have an argument with your team about what shape you want your bearings to be, Instead of circular. We had that argument, and it was never resolved, so...
We could... This is not the size. Yep.
Well, whatever. I mean, this looks pretty cool.
The spools are kind of cool. Yeah. They're spiraled, so the string, you can watch it kind of traverse back and forth. That's so both sides are the exact same diameter at all times, so our string tension is always the same on both sides.
Yeah. One thing that's really important when you do two-sided lifts is getting the sides to be exactly the same. Like, the tension has to be the same, and they have to go up at the same time or it won't work. On top of that, though, they also have to be mounted exactly the same way. If they're not perfectly parallel to each other, they're going to jam like crazy. So as you can see, this is mounted just with, you know, a channel here that is bolted directly to the frame. And, I mean, if our frames weren't parallel, we would have other problems. So these pretty much guaranteed to be parallel, and because this is just coming straight off of it, these are pretty much guaranteed to be parallel as well. Mounts for stuff is kind of interesting. This is water jetted here. These parts here are then laser cut out of an acrylic. I think the idea with that was to reduce static, not have it be a conductor.
No. As you can see, we've broken pretty much every controller we have. All the plastic is cracked because we tighten bolts too much. So we made these acrylic protectors.
Pro tip, don't tighten the bolts ever.
Yeah.
Anyway.
We made these acrylic protectors so when you tighten bolts, it doesn't just like crack all the plastic that bolts on the controllers.
What else?
I could try and explain the pulley system, but it's really complicated.
I guess. Well, talk a little bit about the angles. Why is it... you'll notice it's not straight up and down.
Yeah.
Why did we choose the angles that we did?
Yeah, so... With our lift last year, we had the string kind of do a Z pattern, and it would go up and then down, and then up even further out and then down. And that's for each section. But now we have the section stacked this way instead of this way. So every time we have the pulleys like wrapping back, and it's in the same. Here, come over here. This is really hard. So ignore this string. This string is to pull it down. But we have this string. I don't know how am I going to do this. It comes up, goes behind this section, which has a pulley, then it goes back to the top of that same section, and then it goes down to pull the next section, and then goes up to the next section and pulls this one. It's really complicated. I mean, these were water jetted, and it stops based on where it locks into the next bolt. All of them are telescoping and CAD happened and whatnot. It's really complicated.
Yeah. Works though.
We were gonna have a limit switch here so we could count balls. Yeah.
Always label everything on both ends.
Yeah.
Talk briefly about this, and that's super interesting. We don't want to use the crappy Tamiya connectors, and we don't have the kind of money to buy Anderson power poles. So we just got these kind of sketchy connections here. They're just bait connectors. They can be really hard to get apart sometimes, but if you just sort of screwdriver them a bit, you can get them to a pretty good place. And they're pretty much guaranteed never to come apart, never to fall off during a match or lose the connection. Although, occasionally we've been trying to get them off the charger and like pull the prong straight off the charger, so that's not good. But this is really a decent thing. Power poles are nice, but don't think that you need them to be a good thing. You can pretty much get away with any kind of decent connector. It'll do the job, even this one with screw on and stuff.
Yeah.
Let's see. Is that right, Joe? I can't remember.
Might be nice. Hey, this is worth mentioning.
We finally
have a good NXT mount.
Good NXT mount.
Because it is not Lego, it's aluminum.
Yep.
So you can undo this bolt and then... like take it out.
Yeah, to be honest though, we were always in pastures, we were like, yeah, I need to have an NXT mount that can be really easy to take off. But really, you don't actually take your NXT out, like, ever.
Unless you're bad.
Unless you're bad, and you just don't know how to use it. I guess this doesn't really matter at all, though, because next year.
Yeah. Piano hinges.
Oh yeah, piano hinges.
We were complaining because we didn't want to use them, and then we did, and they're fun.
Yeah, that takes apart, so we would. And it's also bad and dumb.
Oh.
This, you can see, we have sort of an interesting pattern of the brushes here.
that pretty much came about just by doing a lot of testing and just trying random stuff. I don't think I'm going to turn it fast enough.
No, I'm not either. Basically, these two mouse pad flaps are offset. So if we got two balls in the center, this one would be sucked in, and then this one, because they're offset.
We tested it and it worked. It's not super elegant. Also, that phone looks terrible. Like, that's life. We can't afford to buy, like, foam. Foam is, like, actually freakishly expensive, so we just sort of found stuff in people's beds that they wouldn't need.
Yeah, that was in some random part of my house.
And this mouse pad here was cut on the laser cutter over there.
Even better, the mouse pad that was cut on that laser cutter came from these computers.
Oh, yeah.
We don't know if it's the right lines or not.
Yeah, we didn't know something. This is where most of the magic happens, by the way. 3D printer over there, laser cutter, mill, bandsaw. We don't actually use that drill press, but anyway. We did lots of testing. Doesn't look great, but it works. Again, same thing pretty much with the zip ties. Omnibus on the front.
If you're curious, this thing had, I don't remember exact numbers, but it was like 60 3D printed parts, 80 water jetted parts, and like 40 something.
Yeah, I guess it's a good time. Shout out to Mechanical Specialties who cut all the water jet stuff for us. Cut all the water jetted parts for us. They were super helpful, super nice, really enthusiastic. Really made this whole year possible. Also, Universal Sheet Metal from Auburn, they donated pretty much all of the metal that is this robot. We don't really have any money, so this would not have been possible without support from
shout out to Tetrix for making our one Tetrix bracket.
Oh yeah, one Tetrix piece.
This is the only Tetrix piece that's not like a gear or a motor mount.
Bracket, I guess is the proper wording. This metal, kind of cool, just found it sometimes. Yes. There's one other. Oh yeah, if you cut mouse pad on a laser cutter,
don't.
It smells so bad. Probably gives you cancer too.
Yeah. Cutting the foam smelled kind of bad too. Oh, this string is good.
Paracord.
A lot of teams, including ourselves, had trouble getting string that wouldn't break.
Yep.
But we didn't want to use paracord, normal 550 paracord, because it was too thick. This is 275 pound strength, so it's never broken. And it's pretty thin.
Yeah.
Which is
a lot of people don't really understand the mathematics behind this. You think, oh, this thing we're lifting, it's not more than 10 pounds. Why would we need more than the 50 pound string? You do.
Yeah, no, this assembly right here weighs like 4 pounds, I think.
And yet, 270 pounds or whatever. Works great. So,
this was kind of funny. So we had our emergency kit here, and then we had our match schedule
taped inside there.
So, basically we would lose robot. Anything that wasn't the robot.
Yeah.
So our plan was just to have all our tools
we've lost the robot
match schedule on the robot itself.
Oh, here's something we might want to talk about. This is a Lazy Susan bearing thingy.
Oh, from Swerve.
Honestly, this bearing's pretty bad. We haven't really figured out a good solution. You can see this 3D printed gear sort of blue. Anyway, don't tell anyone. Lazy Susan bearings, kind of hard to find good ones. This one isn't good. As you can see, we laser cut these acrylic pieces here to reinforce it this way so it didn't go down there.
It was pretty loose.
Vertically, it's pretty bad. But even as it is, it's decent. Even as it were, though, this thing is really heavy. Would not recommend getting these same bearings. Don't really know where you can get good ones though, so good luck.
Yep. We kind of had that problem with a lot of things. We ended up reinforcing like this acrylic thing.
Yeah.
We don't have the gears in here, but all the gears are trying to pull apart and this would slip. This was our futile attempt to fix that and it didn't work.
Oh, this is kind of nice. Our power switch is mounted in our own acrylic thing in here. Notice how it's flush with the thing. So we don't have a big cover over it, but you don't have to really worry about it ever getting accidentally shut down. This is kind of interesting. I don't know if you can really see the finish on this metal though. It's pretty nice, it's brushed. Levi really took it to heart to make the inside of the robot.
Because we had time for that.
Nice.
Yeah, that was back before we realized how much stuff we had.
Anyway.
That's about it.
Yeah, kind of like just bent out with the heat strip, of course.
Yep. Thanks, Avanti High School.
Oh, one thing, say real quick. All of our servos, you'll notice, are mounted sort of backwards with this thing on this side of the metal.
There was actually no reason for that.
The plastic bit. It doesn't usually matter, doesn't matter here. I will say though, if you do it like this, keep in mind that pretty much all the servos have little ridges on, like, I can't get this one out, but there are little ridges. File these off so that they'd fit there. That's not really a problem. Filing off's not hard, but the one thing you want to keep in mind is that if you have a spare, you should file them off in advance so you don't have to sit there with the competition being like, derp, 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 derp.
I don't know, those are slotted. We could slide this servo back and forth in these slots to adjust the position of that gear.
Good to array if you have multiple servos. If you want to use a splitter, they have to turn the same direction.
Oh yeah, we also made it so you can see the chains slanted right now. Slide out the central gear so all of them can turn freely if it was messing up or something.
Which it messed up a lot.
Oh, I know.
Like I said, these servos, this was one of the biggest challenges of this robot, was getting these four servos to not eat each other. In the end, they pretty much did eat each other all the time, and that was bad. Partly that was just the servos not being great. You can see bearing mounted here.
Anything down here?
Well, we can talk about our sort of decent way we tension this chain.
Not really.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's pretty crappy actually. We basically just made our own little bracket-y thingy here.
Yeah.
That really wasn't so great. It ended up with a lot of like tugging on it really hard with like four people on the robot.
Yeah, you vice grip these two ends, pull that until it breaks.
Someone has to be like, wait, no, I gotta tighten it. You need a lot of hands to do that.
This, I guess, is kind of interesting. This chain is still kind of loose, but we added this aluminum and then 3D printed brace to hold the axle and that axle away from each other, so this chain would be somewhat tight.
You can see the mounts. The NXT motors are fairly robust. There's a bit of a lever here in the end because this was originally possibly going to be spring loaded.
Yeah.
See that steel bracket down there we mentioned earlier. Curved thing there. This was all bent on a brake by hand. Brake's right over there in the other room, actually. Basically, what we did is we designed it all in CAD, dropped metal off it, again, as much as they cut it for us, got it back, bent it. Together.
Yeah. And what wasn't done on the brake, or I mean, the mechanical specialties, we milled some stuff like this, any channel or tubing we had to mill.
This is not bent, obviously, that's just a channel.
Yeah, and that notch is milled out.
That goes into here.
Not that this is actually useful.
Well, whatever. Well, you can see it goes in that little keyhole thingy to keep the small balls from getting stuck.
Yeah. Yep.
This standoff is just here to keep balls out.
Yep.
Okay. Well, anyway, if you've stuck through us through this, if you actually have watched all this video,
you win.
You're a trooper. Just wanted to say thanks for everyone who's supported us through three really rad years and four really great years of high school, besides my accident that kind of sucked. But three really good years of robotics. It was cool. It was fun. All the people here. Hope that all the people on the team, all the businesses that supported us, and everyone we met at competitions. You know. Yeah. it's kind of weird that this thing isn't even going to be in one piece for that much longer, but, you know, it's fun while it lasted.
You guys, is that the printer?